Hello students, hope you all are well at home and doing hard work to achieve the goals. Students, welcome back to the economics class of plus 2 commerce. We have already started lesson number 10, determination of income and employment. We have discussed the topics consumption function, saving function. Today we will start with the new topic investment function. In this we will discuss ex ante and ex post saving and investment, determination of equilibrium level of income and output with different approaches. First one, let's start with the investment function. Investment function represents the willingness and desire of firms to invest in a given time period, like set up new plants, new capital equipments and machinery, new infrastructure like factories, office building, residential houses, etc. And addition to the business inventories, inventories means stock of goods. So investment is measured by amount of total expenditure incurred on these items. There are two types of investment, private investment, public investment. Under the private investment, expenditure incurred by the private entrepreneurs on the purchase of capital goods like plants, machinery, factories, offices, inventory, buildings. In this investment, private sector is motivated by profit maximization. Next one is public investment. Investment undertaken by the government is known as public investment. Investment expenditure by the government on the projects of roads, dams, school, colleges, hospitals, gas and water supply, transportation and housing, etc. And these are motivated by the public welfare only. There is no profit motive in the public investment. Next one is, in macroeconomics there are two types of investment, induced investment and autonomous investment. Under the induced investment, an investment which is undertaken as a result of change in the level of income. An increase in the level of income leads to an increase in the demand for consumer goods, and this leads to an increase in the investment so as to increase the production of consumer goods. So induced investment shows direct relationship with the level of income. Like when we are having income 100, our investment it is rupees 50. When our income increased from 100 to 200, our investment also increased from 50 to 100. With the increase in the level of income to 300, our investment level it is 150. In the same way, this table shows that with the increase in the level of income, our investment level also increases. This shows that investment, it is directly depends upon the level of income having positive relationship. Let us draw these points on the axis. On the x-axis, we will measure income, and on the y-axis, we will measure investment. At 100 level of income, my investment, it is rupees 50. And at 200 level of income, my investment, it is rupees 100. And at 300 level of income, my investment it is 150. After joining all these points, I will get a upward sloping straight line, that is investment curve. This shows that investment depends upon the level of income. With the increase in the level of income, level of investment also increases. Next one is autonomous investment. In this investment, which is not affected by the level of income, it is independent of the level of income. Once the investment it is set by us, only that investment we will do in the economy. There will be no changes whether there is increase in the income or decrease in the income. Let us discuss it with the help of an example. Suppose in the economy income level it is 100. At 100 level of income, government decided to invest 200 level of investment, and when the income level increased to 200, in the same way again the government investment that is 200. At 300 level of income, again the investment remains the same, that is 200. So this shows that With the increase in the level of income, there is no effect on the investment level. It remains the same. So this shows that under the autonomous investment, it is independent of the level of income. When we will draw these points on the axis, like on the x-axis we will measure income and on the y-axis we will measure investment. At 100 level of income, the investment it is 200. At 200 level of income, investment remains the same, that is 200. At 300 level of income, again investment remains the same, that is 200. So after joining these points, we will get a straight line parallel to x-axis, that is known as autonomous investment. Next one is constitute or real investment. Under this, if a household construct a new house with the help of its savings, that is known as constitute or real investment. The purchase of old house, old machinery or old shares are merely a transfer of ownership and it does not add to the stock of the economy, as it is already added in the stock of the economy. There is no construction of new stock or any new product or any new asset. So according to Keynes, all investment is treated as autonomous. Next one is ex ante and ex post saving and investment. First of all, ex ante saving and investment. Ex ante or intended or planned saving is what the saver planned to save at different levels of income in the economy. In the same way, ex ante, intended or planned investment is what the investor planned to invest at the different levels of income in the economy. Suppose my income it is rupees 10,000 and I plan to save at the end of the month rupees 2,000. So rupees 2,000 it is my planned saving. This saving can be increased or can be decreased at the end of the month. Whatever at the end of the month will be in my hand, that will be the actual saving. Suppose I have planned 2000 rupees from my income of rupees 10,000, but at the end of the month what I found that I am having 2500 rupees left with me at the end of the month. So 2500 rupees it is the actual saving, but my planned saving was rupees 2000. In the same way, I planned that I will invest at the end of the month rupees 3000, but at the end of the month there was rupees 3500 in my hand and I have invested rupees 3500. So 3500 rupees it is the actual investment, but the planned investment it was rupees 3000. So what the investor planned to invest at different levels of income, that is known as ex ante or intended or planned investment. Now next one is, let us understand with the help of a table. Suppose at the income level 0, planned consumption it is 20 and planned saving it is minus 20. This planned consumption it is the autonomous consumption because it is independent of the level of income and it depends upon the past savings. Next one is, at the income level 100, my planned consumption it is 100 and my saving it is 0 because whatever I have earned, I have consumed. At 200 level of income, my planned consumption it is 180 and saving it is left over with me, that is 20. So in this way we can calculate the planned saving and the planned investment it is 40 units only at each levels of income because we are working with the autonomous investment. Now next one is, at the level of income, that is 300, planned saving and planned investment both are same. So this is the equilibrium level of the economy where the saving it is equals to the investment. Now next one is ex-post saving and investment. Actual saving and investment in the economy. Suppose I have planned to invest or save rupees 100, but at the end of the month there is a saving or investment of rupees 150. So this is rupees 150 is the actual saving or investment, and the plan was 100. I have planned out for 100, but actually I got 150 at the end of the month. So this is the real investment. In the same way, it can decrease also. Suppose I have planned for 100, but at the end of the month I left over with rupees 80 only. So that is my real investment or actual investment. Now next one is determination of income level and level of income and output. There are two tools, aggregate demand and aggregate supply in the economy, which are helpful to the economy to attain the equilibrium. Now we will analyze the determination of equilibrium of income and output. In our analysis, we will consider only two sectors, that is household and firms. So there will be only two components of aggregate demand, that is consumption demand and investment demand. Let's discuss the assumptions first. Determination of equilibrium output or income is based upon the following assumptions. First one is, this is a short run phenomena, because in the short run aggregate demand is not sufficient to match full employment aggregate supply due to any reason, that is maybe the financial crisis or people are ignorant about the commodities that is available in the economy. Next one is, aggregate supply is perfectly elastic. It is assumed that aggregate supply is perfectly elastic. Perfectly elastic aggregate supply means the supply remains constant at any level of demand in the short run. So it means that when aggregate demand increases, aggregate supply also increases accordingly through the utilization of unemployed resources, mainly labor. So aggregate supply remains the same and aggregate demand will fluctuate, but there is no effect of the price level. So price level remains fixed in the short run. The effects of change in price level on the aggregate demand and aggregate supply are avoided. The assumption of perfectly elastic aggregate supply implies that we are studying the economy where excess production capacity is lying idle, and we are utilizing that production capacity that is untouched or underutilized. That's why there is no effect on the price level, and in the short period we ignore the changes in prices. Now next one is closed economy, third assumption. The determination of equilibrium output or income has been taken up with reference to a closed economy. A closed economy is one which has no trade relation with other countries. So GDP always used in context of equilibrium. Next one is equilibrium level of income and output. How to determine? First of all, we will discuss equilibrium level, where aggregate demand it is equals to aggregate supply. Suppose the aggregate demand for laborers in the economy, that is 100 laborers, and the supply of 100 laborers it is there in the economy. That is the equilibrium point, or you can say that full employment level. We know that aggregate demand it is the summation of two components, that is consumption and investment. And aggregate supply is the summation of the two components, that is consumption and saving. So when we put these values C plus I, it is equals to C plus S. We will take C as a common factor, so I it is equals to S. There are two approaches for the determination of equilibrium level of income, that is aggregate demand and aggregate supply approach, and saving and investment approach. But before this, we will discuss these approaches with the help of an example. was let us understand aggregate demand and aggregate supply approach and saving and investment approach with the help of an example. Suppose in the economy, the income level that is rupees 10,000 crore, consumption it is 8,000 crore and saving it is 1,000 minus 8,000 will give you 2,000 crore. As you know the equation, aggregate supply it is equals to C plus S. Consumption is 8,000, saving it is 2,000, so aggregate supply it is 10,000. And you know that aggregate supply it is the money value of all the goods and services in the economy that forms income. So aggregate supply it is equals to income. Now next one is investment by the firm, that is I it is equals to 2,000 crore. That is the investment decided by the firms that we will invest this much of amount in the economy, or we will give the production to the economy for the goods and services worth rupees 2,000 crore. So we know the equation, aggregate demand it is equals to consumption plus investment. 8,000 plus 2,000 will give you 10,000 crore. So value of aggregate demand that is rupees 10,000 crore and value of aggregate supply also 10,000 crore. So you can say that economy it is in equilibrium. Whatever it is required that is supplied. So aggregate demand it is equals to aggregate supply. And saving also 2,000 and investment that is decided by the firms that is also 2,000. So saving it is equals to investment. Again we can say that economy it is in equilibrium. No undesired inventory stock it is there with the firms. Whatever the firms has thought about the production of goods and services, that much demand it is there in the economy. Suppose if the income of the economy falls from rupees 10,000 crore to rupees 9,000 crore. So why it is equals to, that is income it is equals to rupees 9,000 crore, consumption it is equals to rupees 8,500 crore and saving it is equals to rupees 500 crore. So aggregate supply we can calculate 8,500 crore plus 500 crore will give you 9,000 crore. And aggregate demand C plus I, that is consumption plus investment, 8,500 crore plus 2,000, so rupees 10,500 crore. Now here you can see aggregate demand is 10,500 and aggregate supply it is 9,000. It means that aggregate demand exceeds aggregate supply. So from here we can say that 1500 units demand it is more than aggregate supply. So there is a shortage of goods and services in the economy. And in the same way you can see that savings also less, 500 and investment it is more, that is 2000. As investment remains the same, it is an autonomous investment at all the levels of income. So at this point the economy will produce more in order to satisfy the demand or in order to absorb the excess demand in the economy. So employment will increase, investment will also increase and production also increase, income level will also increase. In the same way, if the income of the economy increases from 10,000 crore to rupees 12,000 crore, then what will happen? Suppose the income it is 12,000, consumption it is 9,000 and savings now it is 3,000 and aggregate supply it is 9,000 plus 3,000, 12,000. That remains the same as the income. Aggregate demand it is C plus I, 9,000 plus 2,000, that is 11,000. So here aggregate demand it is less than aggregate supply. As the value of aggregate supply is 12,000 and aggregate demand it is 11,000. So it means that there is excess supply in the economy and it will affect the economy in this way, that there is cut in the employment level, cut in the income level, and this will continue till the economy will reach to the level where aggregate demand it is equals to aggregate supply. In this you can see that savings are also more and investment it is less. So there is lesser demand in the economy than the goods and services in the economy. So production it is more in the economy at this level of income. So the economy has to cut the employment level. Now let's discuss aggregate demand and aggregate supply approach with the help of a table. According to Keynes, an economy will be in equilibrium when aggregate demand it is equals to aggregate supply. Income it is Y and it varies from 0 to 600 level of income. Planned consumption it is increased with the increase in level of income. And the planned investment that is a autonomous investment in the economy that is 100. And the planned saving you can calculate from here 0 minus 100 will give you minus 100. As this is the autonomous consumption not dependent on the level of income and but it depends upon the level of past savings. Next one is 100 minus 150 will give you minus 50. 200 minus 200 will give you 0 savings. 300 minus 250 will give you 50 savings. In this way you can calculate the savings. Now calculate the aggregate demand. You know that aggregate demand is the summation of consumption plus investment. 100 plus 100 will give you 200. 150 plus 100 will give you 250. 200 plus 0 will give you 200 plus 100 will give you 300. 250 plus 100 will give you 350. In this way you can calculate the aggregate demand. Now calculate aggregate supply. Aggregate supply is the summation of consumption and saving. 100 minus 100 will give you 0. 150 minus 50 will give you 100. 200 minus 0 will give you 200. In this way you can calculate the aggregate supply. From this table you can see here that till the level of income 300, aggregate demand it is more than aggregate supply at each level of income. Aggregate demand it is more and aggregate supply it is less. Aggregate demand it is more, aggregate supply it is less. So this means that it will affect the economy like this, that there is increase in the employment, income level and output level. So it means that still there are untouched or underutilized resources available in the economy. Next one is at 400 level of income, economy it is in equilibrium where aggregate demand it is equals to aggregate supply. Next one is after this at 500 and 600 levels of income, aggregate demand it is less than aggregate supply. So here income will cut down due to the cut down in the employment level and output level will also fall. Now let's read the detail for this one. That is, economy is in equilibrium at 400 level of income where aggregate demand it is equals to aggregate supply. At this level household consume rupees 300 crore and firms invest to rupees 100 crore. So planned or desired expenditure in the economy it is rupees 400 crore, which is equal to the value of outputs of goods and services that the firms are willing to produce in the economy. Now when we will draw the points on the scale, that is on the x-axis we will measure income, on the y-axis we will measure aggregate demand. From here you can see that at 100 level of income, aggregate demand it is 250. At 200 level of income, aggregate demand it is 300. At 300 level of income, aggregate demand it is 350. At 400 level of income, aggregate demand it is 400. At 500 level of income, aggregate demand it is 450. And when we will join all these points, we will get a upward sloping demand curve starts from the y-intercept, because at zero level of income, aggregate demand it is 200. That is autonomous demand. Now next one is, when we will mark the points for aggregate supply at 100 level of income, aggregate supply it is 100. At 200 level of income, aggregate supply it is 200. At 300 level of income, aggregate supply it is 300. After joining these points, we will get a upward sloping aggregate supply curve starting from the origin, making a 45 degree angle. This shows that aggregate supply can be increased, then can be more than aggregate demand, or can be equals to aggregate demand, or can be less than aggregate demand. At point E, aggregate supply and aggregate demand intersect with each other, and this point is known as equilibrium point. As aggregate demand it is equals to aggregate supply. Below the equilibrium point, you can see that income level it is Y2 at 200 level of income, and at this aggregate demand it is Y2H, and aggregate supply it is Y2G. It means that HG amount it is more demand than the aggregate supply in the economy. So aggregate demand it is more than aggregate supply in this segment. Now next one is, we can say that there is a shortage of goods and services in the economy, or you can say that the household sector saves less in this segment. That's why aggregate demand it is more, savings are less. Now next one is, after the equilibrium point, you can see that aggregate demand is less than aggregate supply. In this, household sector saves more. That's why there is a shortage of demand in the economy. Here is excess supply of goods and services, it is there in the economy in this segment. Now next one is, let's read the detail in the diagram. Aggregate demand it is equals to aggregate supply at point E, showing the equilibrium in the economy, that is at Y naught. At 200 level of income, aggregate demand is Y2H and supply it is Y2G. This means that planned expenditure exceeds the output by GH amount, or you can say that savings are less by the household sector. So reduction in the output to maintain inventory stock after equilibrium level at Y1 point AD it is equals to Y1T, that is aggregate demand, and the aggregate supply is Y1R. So RT amount of goods and services it is more than the aggregate demand, because aggregate demand it is lesser here due to the more savings by the household sector. There is excess inventory stock with the, or undesired or unplanned inventory it is with the firms. So after the equilibrium level at Y1 point, AD is equals to Y1T and AS is equal to Y1R. So AS is greater than AD by RT amount. So result, cut in employment and reduction in the output level and income level also. When AD is aggregate demand is greater than aggregate supply, that is income level of rupees 300 crore, household and firms together spend 250 spent by the household sector and 100 by the investment by the firms, but the firms are willing to produce goods and services worth rupees 300 crore. Thus there would be shortage of goods and services worth rupees 50 crore. So this extra demand will met by selling their inventory stock, and this would lead to a undesired decrease in inventories. So firms would then be respond to this undesired reduction in the stock by increasing output and this process will continue, that is increase in the level of output till the economy reach to the level of income of rupees 400. Next one is we will discuss when aggregate demand it is less than aggregate supply. When economy at 500 level of income, which is higher than the equilibrium level of income, as you have seen in the diagram here, at 500 level of income it is higher than the equilibrium level. So at this level of income, consumer and firms together would be buying less goods worth rupees 450, that is 350 plus 100, then the firms would be willing to produce. Firms are willing to produce worth rupees 500 crore. So then there would be excess of goods and services of worth rupees 50 crore that would not be sold. This would lead to undesired increase in inventories of unsold stock. In response to this, firms would decrease the output and continue until the economy is back at output or income level worth rupees 400. Now next one is saving and investment approach. In the saving and investment approach, we are having income level 0 till 600. Planned consumption also increases with the increase in the level of income. Investment, it is our autonomous investment, it remains the same at all levels of income, and from income and consumption we can get the planned saving. At zero level of income, consumption it is 100, as you know that this is autonomous consumption because it is independent of the level of income, and this consumption depends upon the past savings. Next one is 0 minus 100 will give you minus 100. Next one is increase in income, increase in consumption. 100 minus 150 minus 50 savings. 200 minus 200 0 savings. 300 minus 250 consumption 50 savings. So this will continue until we will reach the equilibrium level where planned investment it is equal to the planned saving. Now next one is when we will draw these points on the x-axis and y-axis. On the x-axis we will measure income output, and on the y-axis we will measure saving and investment. So first of all we will mark the points for autonomous investment. At 100 level of income, autonomous investment it is 100. 200 level of income, autonomous investment it is 100. 300 level of income, autonomous investment it is 100. So at all the levels of income, autonomous investment remains the same, that is 100. After joining these points, we will get a straight horizontal line parallel to x-axis. Next one is we will mark the points for saving. At zero level of income, saving it is minus 100. At 100 level of income, saving it is minus 50. At 200 level of income, savings it is 0, because whatever earned it is consumed by the economy. Next one is at 300 level of income, saving it is 50. At 400 level of income, saving it is 100. In this way, when we will join all these points, we will get an upward sloping saving curve that will intersect the autonomous investment curve at point E. This shows that economy it is in equilibrium at this point. But when the income level was 500, at that time savings exceeds the investment. It means that lesser consumption it is in the economy, and due to the lesser consumption, or you can say that more savings in the economy, there is unsold stocks are there with the firms. So there is excess supply of goods and services in the economy, and at this point the firms have to cut the employment level, income level and output level in order to sell the unplanned inventory stock. Now next one is at the income level 300. Here you can see that savings are less at 300 level of income, and investment it is at G. So this GH, it is excess demand in the economy. So this shows that aggregate demand in the economy, it is more than aggregate supply. So at this level, the firms have to increase the employment level in order to satisfy the wants and desires of the economy and increase the employment level, output level and income level till the economy will reach to the equilibrium point, that is E, at the 400 level of income. Now read it. Economy is in equilibrium at 400 level of income, where investment, it is equals to saving, that is planned saving, it is equals to planned investment to rupees 100 crore. Household planned saving, it is equals to the firm's plan to invest. I naught is the investment curve and the saving curve S intersect I naught at 400 level of income at point E. Firms plan to invest at Y naught E amount. See, Y naught E amount. This is the firm's plan to invest. Next one is, suppose the economy is at the level of income rupees 500. Here you can see 500 level of income, where Y1 level of income, here savings are more than investment. Investment is Y1K and savings are RK. Y1K investment and savings are RK. This is more than investment. Household are consuming less than the firm's expectations. So undesired inventory with the firms. So firms cut in production till Y0 level of income it is achieved. Now suppose the economy is at 300 level of income, that is below the equilibrium level of income. Here savings are Y2H, here you can see savings are Y2H and investment it is Y2G. So GH, this much amount it is more demanded in the economy. Next one is, now the firms will increase the level of income till reaching the Y0 level of income, where the planned savings are equals to planned investment. Students, hope you have understood the topic. Now it's time to note down homework. First question, define the following terms: investment, autonomous investment, induced investment, real investment, ex ante saving, ex post saving, ex ante investment, ex post investment. Second question is, determine the equilibrium level of income and output with the help of aggregate demand and aggregate supply approach, investment and saving approach, use diagram. And students, please go through the links on the YouTube for more clarity. Thank you for listening.